Number five, especially if you're doing your revocable living trust yourself, you might not be thinking about everything else that you need. If you have a revocable living trust, you still need all the other estate planning documents. You still need a will. And you might think, why in the world would I need a will? The whole reason I have the revocable living trust is so that my will doesn't need to be probated. Right, that's the whole reason. But always, even if you get an online form, you likely will get what's called a pour over will. Why is it called pour over will? It's a will. The reason it's called a pour over will is that more often than not, when people have revocable living trusts, they have not captured all the assets that should have been put in the trust. So what happens on their death is there is a trust administration and there is a probate. The probate is so that the assets that weren't put in the trust can be captured through the probate process. Probate is your wills filed with the court, the executor is appointed. Any assets that aren't in the trust and that aren't otherwise directed to pay will be captured and now put back into your trust. So you've not only got a trust administration going on, but a probate. The whole reason for the revocable living trust was so that you wouldn't have a probate. So that is a very common situation, is that there needs to be a probate plus the trust. So if you have a revocable living trust, you will have a will too, especially if an estate planning lawyer does it for you. They just know that too frequently people need a will as well. Don't forget about your very, very important lifetime documents. You need those even if you have a revocable living trust. And those lifetime documents are your durable power of attorney, and that will be a durable power of attorney for finances so that somebody can manage your finances. And you go, why do I need that? I have everything in the trust. Well, a lot of times people don't have things in the trust. Or remember, we talked about assets that can't go in your trust, your 403B, your 401K. That durable power of attorney then gives that trusted person you've appointed authority to manage those assets if you lose capacity. So you need a durable financial power of attorney. You'll also need a durable power of attorney for healthcare. That's so that person can speak to your doctor, to talk to your doctor about your medical care when you're not able to do so by reason of a stroke, accident, etc. So I name these as two separate documents, durable power of attorney for finance, durable power of attorney for health. They don't have to be two separate documents. A lot of times people put them into one. Because of the nature of the work that we do at ELG Estate Planning, helping with long-term care costs, protecting assets, our documents are very robust. They're very comprehensive. So we find that it's easier to have them as two separate. And for another reason, sometimes you would name, maybe your daughter is going to be the power of attorney for you for your health care, and maybe your son will be for finances and vice versa. So having the two separate documents makes it easier to designate different people. Other lifetime documents, your living will or your health care directive. That is where you put in writing that if you are deemed to be at end of life in a permanent vegetative or terminal condition, and two physicians have put that in writing in your chart, that's where you say, do you want heroic measures or would you prefer to be given comfort measures only and be allowed to pass? So all of those documents are important to have. So a revocable living trust is just one piece of the estate planning puzzle. You need all of those other documents. And keep in mind also that the beneficiary designations, which is probably the most overlooked part of an estate plan, because it's really not an estate planning document, but you need help and guidance on how should you set up your beneficiary designation. Should you say that the IRA pays to your trust or to your spouse and the alternate to your kids? Should you say your IRA pays to an asset protection trust or a different type of trust? So a beneficiary designation is often overlooked. And sometimes people think, well, my trust will manage it. Not necessarily. You might may or may not know this, but retirement plans, especially like 403Bs, 401Ks, they'll have their own set of default rules unless somebody consents to something different. So for example, it might say that it pays to your spouse. Maybe your spouse, you just married them 6 months ago. They'll get all of your assets. Your kids will get none unless they consent to not receiving the assets, even if it's your separate property. So you have to be aware that retirement accounts and beneficiary designations are a critical part of your estate plan, and just having a revocable living trust isn't going to handle that piece of it. So don't overlook the other really important estate planning documents you need. And that is the fifth biggest mistake that people have, is overlooking those documents.